The world of electronics is insanely diverse. There are literally millions of electronic parts out there. For a beginner, it's like being dropped into a jungle of resistors, capacitors and mysterious black chips. If you try to buy everything at once, you'll burn through a wallet faster than a fried transistor. And still, at the most critical moments, you'll discover you're missing that one tiny part. In this video, I'll show you how to pick just the essential components you'll need most often, the budget-friendly building blocks that can power a whole bunch of fun little projects. Let's start with the basics. The tools for soldering and assembling circuits. I won't dive deep into soldering gear, that's a topic for another video, but here's the must-have trio. A soldering iron, soldering supplies, and a multimeter. When it comes to soldering irons, I've tried everything from budget to fancy. If you can, grab a smart soldering iron. It's so much more convenient. But hey, even a $3 AliExpress iron with copper tips can do the job, if you know how to tame it. Now solder and flux. My go-to is Sinel, a Polish brand with 2.5 flux inside. Solid, reliable and easy to find. Fluxes vary. Washable, no clean, or just plain rosin. Another famous manufacturer is Amtec. So you will meet a lot of Amtec fakes. Again, that's another rabbit hole we can explore in a separate video. Drop a like if you want me to go full solder nerd mode in the future. Accessories. Definitely grab a silicon mat. It's heat resistant and cleans up easily. Also a third-hand tool. Trust me, your two hands will never be enough. For quick builds, a breadboard is a lifesaver. You can test, tweak and rebuild a circuit dozens of times without soldering a single joint. Pair it with jumper wires and pin headers. Those little strips you can break into chunks and solder onto modules. Perfect for plug-and-play experiments. Breadboards have limits. They choke on high current and high frequency, so eventually you'll want proper prototyping boards for soldering. Every project needs power. Beginners usually deal with low voltage. 5V and 12V are the big ones. A lab power supply is a dream tool. Variable voltage and current. It is stable and safe. But you can also repurpose old phone chargers, LED strip power bricks, or even use your PC USB port. By the way, you can get these little adapters that lets you power your breadboard straight from a USB port or a DC supply, giving you a nice stable 5 or 3.3 volts. Just a heads up though, don't trust them too much. They can be a bit sketchy, and I'll show you why later in this video. Just one golden rule: avoid direct mains electricity. Always use supplies with proper isolation. Your safety depends on it. For input, grab some tactile push buttons, the small 6mm ones and the chunkier 12mm versions. You can find buttons with different heights and even a bright colorful caps of all forms and sizes. For output, LEDs are your best friends. The classic 3mm green or red LEDs only need a few milliamps, but remember, never connect them directly, always add a resistor. sound. You'll need a buzzer if you just want a beep. That's simple. You supply DC voltage and it beeps. For more fancy audio stuff, you may need a small speaker. As a beginner, prefer more resistance. 16 or 32 ohms is perfect, if you want to actually play tones without frying your circuit. Less resistance, more current, more risk to fail. Talking about resistors, get a starter pack of just zero key values. That's enough to cover most beginner projects, like running an LED from 5 volts require 470 ohms, or from 12 volts with 1 kilo ohm. Also handy these trimmer potentiometers, 10 kilo ohm and 100 kilo ohm. Great for fine-tuning in breadboards, fits into it perfectly. As for capacitors, start with electrolytics. 1 or 2000 microfarads rated for 16 volts or more. Add some ceramic ones. It usually rates for 50 volts. Film capacitors are cool for audio purpose, but buy them later, when you know you need them. Diodes, just 3 models for beginners. 1N4007 is a universal 1 amp power diode. 1N5408 provides higher current the whole 3 amps. And finally, probably you need 1N4148. It's a signal diode, super fast and tiny. Let's speak a bit about voltage regulators. Grab 7805 and 7812, but exactly in this package and well-known brand, such as STM. They've got built-in protections against short circuits, overcurrent and overheating. Unlike, for example, LM317 regulators on some cheap breadboard supplies. Those things can fry themselves and your project. I've done that. And then cried over that unique retro display. I recommend two models of bipolar transistors. SS8050 is a NPN structure and SS8550 it's a opposite PNP structure. Affordable, versatile, they are great for beginner circuits. You can find this exact model in through-hole and SMD package, that is very convenient. If you need more power, look for 13007, often found in old fluorescent lamp drivers. Different manufacturers produce various versions of this transistor, but if you see those numbers on the appropriate package, most likely that's it. More specific part is Zener diodes. Grab a 5.1 volts one just to play around. It's also handy for protecting 5 volt line from overvoltage. And then I'll show you just one other chip, the legendary NE555 timer. With it you can build oscillators, timers and about a million other fun circuits. Definitely worth to buy it. Of course, modern DIY electronics is all about microcontrollers. Arduino, STM32, ESP32, they make prototyping fast and accessible. Pair them with a 1602 LCD display or a shift register like HC595 when you need more digital outputs. You can even chain those registers as much as you want to get even more outputs. And for pure LED magic, they created a 2812 addressable LEDs. If you saw them only in a LED strip, I'll tell you that they come into all shapes and sizes, and your imagination is the only limit. I hope this beginner's guide helps you get started. If it did, give it a thumbs up, subscribe and get ready, because your ideas deserve to become real.